Civilizations are built of people. Families and individuals make up nations. Every nation is built of the same basic building blocks. The recipe for a healthy, strong England has to include healthy numbers of healthy Englishmen. Don't forget the recipe. There is only one way to make an Englishman. You need an Englishman and an Englishwoman, the most precious thing in the world. We face a very severe crisis because of the way our girls are being socialized and educated. They are being taught all the wrong values. We tell our girls to be tolerant and open and friendly to strangers and foreigners. They are taught that their careers and their personal enrichment should come before motherhood. A woman who is 30 years old and has no children is letting down her people as well as her family. It's really that simple. The idea that men can or should go their own way is a recipe for racial and national suicide. It just isn't an option. Don't forget the recipe. There is only one way to build a strong England, and that is with people, our own children. We all need to take responsibility. If everybody did what we did, would the world be a decent place or not? It is not tenable to have no children and expect that other people will have them for you, and your taxes will pay to indoctrinate those children with your values, or even that they be taught to think like you think. If you have no children, you have no moral right to any say in how children are raised. Any children. Of course you are entitled to your opinion and your vote, but there is no good reason why anybody should feel that your views deserve to be taken into consideration, like Catholic priests advising about sex, or people who never buy a lottery ticket pontificating about how the money raised should be spent. Without English women having children with English men, there will be no more England. The nation will die. The land will remain but will not be the same. The idea that men can go their own way is the most selfish and depressing idea of the 21st century. There is only one way to have a future. We need to have children. Our children, with our values and our culture. We must never forget the recipe. Every English child needs an English mother, and they also need at least one English sibling. If people like you are not having their right share of children, if they are not replacing their genes in the future with a half share in at least two children, you should consider taking up the slack on their behalf. If your friends and siblings have no children and scorn the idea, you should take up the burden, or else the future will look very different from the present, and every sacrifice made in the past by our ancestors, the ordinary ones as well as the bright and glorious ones, will have been in vain. Of course not everybody wants children, but if everybody who didn't want children didn't have any, and everybody else restricted themselves to two children at the most, the nation will die a long, slow, lingering, and pitiful death. In the 19th century, the white population exploded in Europe and America. This led to the progress of the 20th century, which transformed the world, but that population explosion has fizzled out completely. There were a couple of small bursts in what we call the baby boom generation, and when that generation came of age to have their own children, but that was the last movement of the great population upheaval, which began in Britain and France in the late 18th century. That led to the peak in the proportion of white people in the world. Since 1970, things have changed around. The population of the planet is growing. It has more than doubled in my lifetime. But the population of white people is on a downward trend. In every white majority country, the population is changing. The fertility of white people has collapsed. Population growth is coming entirely from non-white people. We haven't seen the population nosedive yet because of the age profile. The baby boomer generation is only just getting into the peak dying years. Our population numbers are still quite high because of large numbers of people over 50. If you take those out of the equation, as biology inevitably will, the picture is much more alarming. The productive age groups, those who can fight wars and bear children, show an alarming drop in numbers compared to previous generations, and the age group who will become the productive group in 15 to 30 years' time is smaller still. No nation has ever survived such a population slump. I hate being pessimistic and I don't want to spread any sense of futility, but we need to be alert to the reality. The simple message is this: if you want to have a good future, you need to have a fertility rate per woman or per person, which is almost the same thing, which is closer to 2 than any other integer. That is the recipe for national success and survival. If your fertility rate is 3 or over, you will run into population growth problems, which will drive nasty policies such as imperialism and war. If it is nearer to 1 or even lower, you will be on the slow, inevitable road to annihilation. You won't replace your population. Each age cohort will be smaller than the one it tries to replace, and you will have a terrible future of old people looking lost and dispossessed. Old people who remember a time when things were better, when there were children in the streets, when life was good, when the future was bright. You can see such sights today in many rural areas, especially in southern Europe. It isn't the in-your-face desperation of sickly children standing in pools of raw sewage, but in a way it is worse. At least those third world shantytowns have children in them. Many rural parts of England are like that already. Churches which have 5 or 6 funerals for every wedding or baptism. That isn't good, and common sense should tell you that isn't sustainable. Schools which 40 years ago were full of white English children are now full of every other kind, and in the rural areas, the schools have all closed. We need to turn this around. I am not prepared to see England die. It is not yet too late. While our population will fall, that is, the population of native people, it need not be a permanent slide. If we leave it another 40 years before we do anything, the efforts needed will be too great. But if we start now, we can address the slide before it gains too much momentum. To bounce back in another 40 years would require us to have families of the size not even Irish Catholics or Mormons have any longer. To start now, we can do wonders just by making families of 3 and 4 children seem normal and healthy, and women who reach their mid-30s without making any attempt to breed should be regarded as antisocial, selfish bitches, rather than empowered, striving women who know their own mind. It will not require a revolutionary change, just a slight tweak to our social attitudes. Something could be done by changing the tax structure to make marriage more attractive, that's proper marriage, between a man and a woman. More could be done at no expense to the taxpayer at all by tapping into the free advertising, which is currently only used to advertise tolerance, miscegenation, and man-hating. What do I mean by that? Just open your eyes and look. How many advertisements which are ostensibly for sportswear companies, restaurants, soft drinks, clothes shops, flat pack furniture stores and broadband suppliers are actually lifestyle advertisements which by rights should be paid for by the cultural Marxists of the Frankfurt School. There are advertisements which normalize homosexuality, reverse sex roles, single motherhood, childlessness, immigrant families and miscegenation. Why? What is the connection between those messages and the products they are supposed to be selling? If advertisers can pick the pockets of their clients to spread cultural Marxist propaganda, why can't the same methods be used to spread a really worthwhile message instead? What do I mean by a worthwhile message? How about study a vocational subject and stop when you are employable? Don't take a year off. Save up for your future from your first pay packet. Get married to somebody of the opposite sex who wants to have children. Somebody of your own race, so your parents will be more related to their grandchildren than to their neighbor's children, and your children will look like they belong to you. Have enough children to replace you, your spouse, and all the gays, the infertile, and those too tied up with their careers, cats and yappy little dogs, to have any stake in the future of their own people. A start could be made simply by depicting families of 3 and 4 white children as normal and something to aspire to, rather than dysfunctional. Of course, some people will say that the world is overpopulated, but you don't solve third world overpopulation by changing the numbers born here, just the same as you can't cure obesity in Europe by encouraging Ethiopians to cut down on fatty food. There are too many children being born in Africa, India, and Central and South America. They have an overpopulation problem. In Britain, we have a declining native population, partially masked by massive immigration, much of it illegal and poorly documented. The solution is simple for everybody, everywhere. Maintain your fertility at a rate nearer to 2 than any other integer. It's just that simple. A fertility rate running between 1.5 and 2.5 gives a population which isn't expanding or declining at a dangerous rate. It is within the bounds of what we can manage. But with many advanced industrialized societies having fertility rates less than 1.5, the change in population size is too steep, and there is no historical precedent for any society ever surviving such a decline. Never. Nowhere. Whenever a population's fertility rate drops below 1.5, that population is collapsing. The society is dying, never to recover. Of course, a nation of 60 million people will not disappear overnight. It takes decades, but it is inevitable. Imagine two different populations. Both start with a population size of 100. Let's assume both populations have a chance of forming couples of 45%. That is, 100 people will be approximately 50 males and 50 females. Some won't want to form couples. Some will be gay, some will be too ugly, weird or picky or just unlucky. So 100 people will likely form 45 heterosexual couples. So far the two groups are the same. Now let's make them different. One group has the social conditioning and so on to make them likely to have an average family size of 2.2 children per couple. The other group thinks these people are dinosaurs. These hipsters enjoy life, or they delay marriage, or getting settled in a career takes longer than they would like. Whatever the explanation, they have an average of 1.4 children per couple, a figure quite typical of modern European countries. What is the result? Work it out for yourself. The first group has 45 couples, producing 99 children, who go on to form 44 couples, who go on to have 97 children, who go on to form 43 couples, who go on to have 95 children. In three generations, the number of children produced has dropped 5%, a quite manageable soft decline which would be unlikely to cause any long-term issues to the society or the economy. 2.2 children per couple is a reasonable figure. Gaia would wholeheartedly approve. In contrast, the group which has 1.4 children per couple has only 63 children from the same 45 couples. The 63 children, in turn, can only form 28 couples, who would have only 39 children. These could form a mere 18 couples, which in turn could have only 25 children. One group declined from 100 to 95 in three generations. The other went from 100 to 25 in the same time. A country which dropped from 100 million people to 25 million in three generations, which is about 84 years, would be a complete basket case. But if that happened in a country with open borders, a socialist-infested education system, and a Ponzi scheme of pensions paid for by the current generation of workers, what would be the result? The shortfall of children and productive workers would be drawing in immigrants to take their place. Chances are that the population would not drop from 100 million to 25 million. It probably wouldn't drop at all. The slow breeders would be ousted by outsiders. Even if we assume that the outsiders in turn adopt the low breeding habits of the natives, a rather naive assumption, we are still looking at population replacement from an overwhelming majority to a minority in a single human lifetime. That is without even considering the effect of miscegenation. Many Jews have bemoaned the fact that they are facing terminal decline because half their children marry outside their community in every generation. This suggests that liberally minded people stand about a 50% chance of marrying outside their own group if they are surrounded by people from that outside group. There has indeed been a very rapid increase in the number of mixed-race children in Britain. One mechanism we must be aware of is how black men manipulate white girls into unprotected sex by playing the race card. "You're only saying no because I'm black." Whereupon she proves she isn't a racist and promptly falls pregnant to him, and she can't abort the unwanted child because that would be racist. She then raises that mixed-race child using the resources of the state and her family, which then becomes a mixed-race family. She also, for the child's good, teaches it to respect its father, who, like Barack Obama Sr., has long since vanished from the scene. So we have the pathetic sight of white mothers teaching their children to like reggae and rap and identify with a black father who she knew for fully 45 minutes because she went to a nightclub in a short skirt when she was ovulating and lacking in self-esteem. We need to tell our daughters that you can prove you are not a small-minded racist hater without having a mixed-race child. It's not racist to refuse to have sex with somebody you barely know. Women don't have sex with millions of men every day, all day long. It's what women do more often than anything else. Women don't have sex with men almost all the time. Look out of your window. I bet you can see some women doing it right now. Not having children is pretty much the same as an open invitation to immigration and population replacement. You are giving your country away to those who are prepared to make the lifestyle sacrifices to have children. One thing you can be sure of, they won't have your children for you. They won't have your genes. They won't look like you or your cousins. They won't have your failed values either. The children they will be taught by their parents about the virtues of their ancestors and the vices and atrocities of yours. They will be taught about heroes of their history and culture, and not Shakespeare, Nelson, or Drake. They will not respect you or your parents or the values of your society, culture, or religious beliefs. They will probably regard you with faint contempt. They might hide it at first while you are still the majority, but when you become just another minority, they will tell you what they think about you to your face. They will have no sympathy for your dispossession whatsoever. They will think you deserved everything which was coming to you. You lost track of what life is all about. You forgot the recipe.